That way to the parking lot of Disneyland, built in 1955, Anaheim's most famous landmark.
But we're not going to Disneyland today.
Bye!
Today we're going to one of Disneyland's smallest competitors.
The tiniest theme park you've ever seen, Adventure City.
This is Beach Boulevard, the main thoroughfare for this part of Orange County to the ocean.
The beach is way down that way, and way down this way is Knott's Berry Farm.
Highway 39, the big road to the ocean, the perfect place for a tourist attraction.
Today, it's Adventure City, a very small theme park designed for very small children, but this wasn't always the case.
Before there was a theme park for small children here called Adventure City.
This place on the border of Anaheim and Stanton, California was known as Hobby City.
Way back in 1955, the same year Disneyland opened, a couple by the name of Jay and Bea DeArmond bought a chicken farm right here off the side of what is now Beach Boulevard.
And created an amazing roadside destination.
See, the DeArmonds were super into hobbies.
Their motto was, a hobby family is a happy family.
And so they dreamt of a place where the whole family could come and pursue their hobbies. A whole city of hobbies. Hobby City.
And today I'm taking a look at what's left.
Most of the property is now taken up by that amusement park, Adventure City.
And as a matter of fact, there really isn't even a sign for Hobby City anymore. Just one small mention up there. But there are still quite a few remnants left over of this original roadside attraction.
Now, Bea DeArmond, her big hobby was collecting dolls. She had a massive doll collection.
So, of course, Hobby City had to have a doll shop, and it was located right in this building. Not much to look at now, but if you take a look at old vintage pictures of the place, you can clearly see the fairy tale style of architecture. I don't think they sell dolls in this building anymore, but it's still standing.
You can see right from the beginning, one of the big ideas when it came to Hobby City was themed buildings.
The old school way of thinking meant Fantasyland style buildings for the girls, and of course, some old west buildings for the boys.
Check it out, a log cabin on the side of the road in Anaheim.
Now, interestingly, I've been told that at one point, this was actually called the Yarn Cabin, and it was a yarn hobby store.
You know, yarn, crocheting, knitting, sewing, that kind of thing.
But the way I remember is that this log cabin sold Native American gifts and sundries, and some old pictures actually bear out my memories. You can definitely see that the building hasn't changed much over the last few decades. It's still pretty much intact and just the way I remember it being when I was a kid.
You see, Hobby City was awesome if you grew up around here.
Every single one of these buildings held a different shop related to different hobbies.
And you could come down here and check them all out basically for free. It was pretty awesome, especially if your family was low on dinero, right?
So this is one of the places we would come all the time.
Now my memory's getting a little hazy and obviously things have changed quite a lot, but what I remember is that this building over here
was once the pet store at Hobby City.
And I'm about 90% sure, mostly because of these windows.
Dude, we loved going into that pet store with our dad.
Not quite sure if it was the late 80s or the early 90s, but at one point they had a giant fish tank in there with a live piranha.
I distinctly remember the shopkeep in the pet store telling us all about how piranha could basically turn a cow into bones in just a few seconds and made him sound all gnarly and scary.
I think we may even have bought a few goldfish from this place way back in the day.
Sadly now, no more pets in the old pet shop. I wonder what happened to that piranha.
Probably went down the toilet to goldfish heaven to hang out with my goldfish. Yeah, that's probably it.
Then of course, next door to the pet shop was a massive hobby shop.
Now I'm not sure how they've divided up the buildings. I'm not sure if there was actually more than one store in this building or not.
But I remember one of these doors led to a giant model shop. I mean, they had models of everything. Planes, cars, battleships.
And of course, model trains.
Look at this. There's still a little evidence of the old days up there. Look at that hand-painted train sign.
I can't remember if the main hobby model shop and the train shop were separate or all in one in this building.
It's actually really hard to find old photographs of Hobby City anywhere.
For the few that I do have, I owe a huge debt of gratitude to Chris Jepson from the Orange County Archive. archives. He helped me a lot to track down some old images.
But if anyone out there has any more, I'd love to see them.
The interesting thing about Hobby City that I didn't learn until years and years later after I had grown up was that almost all of the stores at Hobby City, and there were dozens of them, I think over 20 shops.
Almost all of them were run by a member of the DeArmond family, or the Ansdell family.
Who were all related by marriage and blood and whatnot.
Now looking around here in the last couple years was kind of confusing for me because I remembered there being a lot more stores, particularly in this area. Luckily, one of the few pictures I was able to find online backs up my memories. You can see, comparing that old photograph to what's here now, that these palm trees remain, but an entire row of buildings has been removed. At one point, those were all hobby shops. I'm not sure what else those missing buildings contained, but I do know that they did contain the dugout, the good old baseball card store.
So I do remember having to come into the baseball card shop.
And if my memory is correct, just across this little walkway here, right over in these buildings facing out on the main road,
was the epicenter of the craziest craze of the 80s.
Because I'm pretty sure that this building right over here,
and potentially the one next to it, but I think it was this one,
was the home of the Cabbage Patch Kids Adoption Center.
Do you guys remember Cabbage Patch Kids? They might still make Cabbage Patch Kids for all I know.
But while now they're kind of a curiosity, in the 80s they were massive.
And they were actually very hard to get. I'm told that the family here
had to make regular trips to Europe and all over the world to get enough Cabbage Patch Kids to meet demand. They were hard to find.
Dude, and they had them all here. They had all these crazy outfits, all the rare dolls from all over the world. Wasn't that interesting? To me as a little boy in the 80s.
I was more interested in Ninja Turtles, Ghostbusters, Batman, that sort of thing.
But just the sheer frenzy of people trying to get their clutches on a Cabbage Patch doll and how much stuff was in there is hard to describe now.
Only a few old pixelated images exist online. It's all I could find of the old Cabbage Patch Adoption Center in there.
Oh, that's right. It was an adoption center. You got a birth certificate. They had a doctor on call here and a nursery where your Cabbage Patch thing would get born in this elaborate ceremony.
From what I understand, there are still Cabbage Patch places like that in existence in the world, but no longer any Cabbage Patch here at Hobby City. However,
there's still remnants of yet another doll-related store.
It wasn't enough to have the doll shop back there and the Cabbage Patch Kids Adoption Center. They also had the teddy bear tree.
Dude, look at this rad building.
It's a building shaped like a gigantic redwood tree stump.
I was actually in Northern California not that long ago looking at a gas station made out of an actual giant redwood stump.
But this building is much, much larger.
This was the teddy bear shop. They sold hundreds of different kinds of teddy bears.
Well, I don't know exactly how many different kinds of teddy bears. I was a kid after all, but it sure seemed like hundreds, and look at the doorway here.
You can still see the hand-painted remains.
The few signs to tell the tale of what was the teddy bear treehouse.
Now this building is obviously not made out of an actual redwood tree. It's far too big.
It's made out of concrete, and to me that makes it even more impressive. Look, you can still see little flakes of metal and just the texture of that.
I love unique, rare things, and I love one-of-a-kind buildings like this.
My Aunt Tina loved teddy bears as a kid. I'd always come in here and think, wow, this is where I should buy Aunt Tina a birthday present.
Sadly, that'll never happen. I can no longer buy Aunt Tina teddy bears in the teddy bear tree stump.
These days, this front door is no longer functional, and the new entrance to the treehouse is inside Adventure City.
Because the old teddy bear treehouse
has become the party tree.
Now your kid can have a birthday at Adventure City
and have the party inside the old teddy bear tree.
I'm kind of jealous. I never had a party inside a tree.
Look at this. I never noticed this in my entire life. There's a heart carved right in to the tree.
It says A plus Y.
I don't know who A and Y are, but I hope that they're still in love.
Otherwise, this thing on the tree is probably a little awkward.
No more flowers in the planters. The windows are all boarded up, although very cleverly camouflaged, I must say.
They did a good job on those.
And you can see that the main entrance is now firmly inside of the fence for Adventure City.
But there is one more relic out here, the old teddy bear drinking fountain.
Look at that concrete bear right there. I was gonna say he barely has any water anymore, but that's not true. Look, it still works.
Can I have a drink, Mr. Bear? I'm so thirsty.
Why, sure, friend.
Does it look sanitary? Ugh. History water.
Oh yeah, That drinking fountain's seen some better days, but thankfully they haven't ripped it out or replaced it.
Dude, that is amazing. That is an unexpected piece of my childhood still left out here at Hobby City.
Ooh, I always thought this guy was concrete, but apparently he's fiberglass.
Dude, that is so cool.
His friends may have left the neighborhood, but the drinking fountain bear is still here.
Ready to help thirsty travelers on their way to the beach.
That is so awesome.
Now, the teddy bear treehouse is right along Beach Boulevard.
So thousands and thousands of people drive by it every day or ride by on the bus and probably wonder, what the heck was that?
It's definitely always been an attention getter, but what you don't notice from the street
is that there's an even more epic and arguably even more impressive building in the back.
And this one might look familiar to you.
Bam, bam, bam.
Would you look at this?
It's the White House!
In Anaheim!
Yes, my friends, that is a scale replica of the White House.
A half-scale replica, to be exact.
I've seen the real White House in real life, but as I'm standing here looking at the half-scale version,
I'm trying to double it in my mind, you know, make it twice as big, and all I can think is,
man, even the real White House must be pretty small.
Yes, friends, look at this.
A half-scale replica of the White House located right here in Orange County, California.
Now you remember Jay and Bea, the couple who founded this place and turned it from a chicken ranch into a city of hobbies?
Well, of course, they're the ones who built this fantastic White House replica. You see, Bea was tired of the commute back and forth to Hobby City, and she also wanted a place to put her massive doll collection.
So her husband Jay built her a house, and not just any house, but a White House.
I believe this was built in the early 1970s, and originally downstairs,
it was the home of Bea DeArmond's massive 4,000 plus doll collection.
So it was known as the Hobby City Doll and Toy Museum.
If you look closely way up there in that triangle, you could still faintly make out where the letters used to be for the Hobby City Doll and Toy Museum.
For just 50 cents for a kid or a dollar for a grown-up like us,
you could go inside and look at Bea's collection of over 4,000 dolls. I can't repeat that number enough. More than 4,000.
Dude, that's a lot of toys.
I think I only came in here once or twice as a kid. It was mostly, you know, girl dolls, so I wasn't that interested in it. But what I never knew as a child is that upstairs above the doll museum,
that entire upper floor of the White House was Jay and Bea DeArmond's home.
That's right, the founders and owners of Hobby City, the grandparents to all those folks running all these shops over here,
actually lived right up there.
Bea didn't want a long commute to work, and she didn't want to leave her dolls behind, so why not move onto the property?
Now, like I said before, I only went in there once or twice as a kid, but when I got older, when I was 16 or so still a kid, just a bigger one,
I actually worked right over there in Adventure City.
So, of course, I would take my lunch breaks out here. I would show up really, really early. It was one of my first jobs, and I was always nervous that I was going to be late, so I'd show up early and kind of sit in my car over here.
And eventually, to refresh my memory, I wandered into the Doll and Toy Museum.
I had no idea that that little friendly old lady that greeted me at the door and refused to take my dollar to see the collection every time
not only owned and founded the place, but actually lived upstairs. And unlike when I was little, it was much more fascinating when I was a little bit older, you know, because the Doll and Toy Museum didn't just have, like, porcelain dolls and stuff.
They had over 500 Barbies as well, and a ton of old school G.I. Joes, which I also thought were fascinating. Also, Mego superheroes.
Just goes to show you, I should have had a more open mind as a child. Kids,
I know sometimes your parents want to drag you into some place that seems pretty boring, but trust me, a lot of the times, you're gonna thank them for it later, so just try to be patient.
There's a lot of fun stuff to see.
Sadly, a little after the turn of the century, my little old lady friend, Bea, passed away,
and her doll museum closed its doors for the last time. I have no idea what actually happened to all those dolls in there.
But these days, they use the downstairs, at least, of the White House as a fancy events center.
No one's here at the moment, so I can't get a look inside, but they're always advertising this space for rent for corporate events and parties and stuff like that.
I never did get to see the upstairs of this building.
I'm really curious as to what's up there now, whether or not anyone lives there, but if you look at the windows and the way the top part of those windows has sort of fallen down a little bit, I kinda doubt anyone lives there at the moment.
Pretty cool that the White House still remains out here, the half-scale White House.
But it's kinda sad that the doll museum is gone, and it's not the only thing that's left. There's a lot of stuff missing from over there.
Now, most of the stuff we've looked at so far is off of Beach Boulevard through Hobby City's main entrance there.
And that's also most of what's left and open to the public. But if you swing around this way, you'll notice they have a lot more space on this property.
This whole area that's now a parking lot
used to have a bunch of buildings in it.
Definitely right in this area here, there were more buildings. Including a very old seashell shop here. Oh, that's hard to say. Seashell shop. Seashell shop.
That had some awesome tikis out in front of it.
When I started getting really into tiki stuff, I actually came down here hoping that building was still here to see if maybe I could buy those tikis off the building or something like that.
When to my horror, I discovered that those buildings were entirely gone.
When I was a kid, my mom used to go into that seashell shop and buy stuff. I know there were dollhouses for sale in one of the little buildings over here, things like that.
All kinds of little knickknacks and paddywhacks right in this area.
But later I know that that old seashell shop, which had the tikis out front of it that was all sort of Polynesian themed, was converted into a place called Radical Reptiles, and they had lizards and chameleons and whatnot for sale here.
Frogs and iguanas and everything else, all right in this general area.
So anyway, of course I had to try to Google it and see what happened to those tikis.
Which is how I first came across Chris Jepson's blog, where he had some pictures of the old tikis and the old Treasure Cove seashell shop, which had been converted into Radical Reptiles, etc., etc.
Turns out I wasn't the only one who remembered those tikis. They are apparently highly sought after. So if anyone has any information, there are a lot of people who want to know what happened to the 1959 Hobby City tikis.
Yes. All gone now, but now we come to my favorite part of old Hobby City, this grassy lawn.
Way back in the day, there used to be a miniature train ride going right through this area.
If memory serves, it was only about $1 or 50 cents. It was really cheap to ride on that train. So of course, when my mom came to look at dollhouses and seashells, and my dad wanted to look at model cars
or cake decorating supplies or whatever the heck they were doing down here, my brother and I were like, oh, the train, yes, the train.
It used to come right through this area, and the train itself was actually built by Bud Hurlbut,
the guy who built and basically invented all the rides at Knott's Berry Farm, all the old classic ones. So it had a kind of a local history connection.
Dude, there were murals painted on all these buildings, like Old West looking murals. It was a lot of fun. And it was cheap, you know?
Somewhere, there's a picture of my brother and I, or my dad and my brother, someone, in that train at Hobby City. I hope one day I can recover that picture. I'll share it online on Instagram or something.
Look, there's the train now. There it is, the Hobby City train. It's still here. Look at those cars. Those are the very same cars I sat in as a kid. Wow. It was a big part of my childhood out here. They also had like a Western store that had guns, tons and tons of guns. I don't know if they were replicas or real guns, but there were guns over here.
Of course, you don't see the train behind me now, but the train is not entirely gone, because in 1994...
the train moved just a little ways away inside of the brand new Adventure City.
It's been hard to find information on the family during my research. Very, very difficult. But I think what happened is that Bea and Jay's daughter, Yvonne,
married a fella named Alan Ansdell.
Ooh, which is probably what the Y and the A was on the treehouse. Yvonne and Alan, question mark?
Anyway, according to the information I can dig up, Yvonne and Alan,
and their son Alan Jr., and I'm assuming the rest of the family,
noticed how many people came here with their tiny children just to ride that little train and heeded all of those questions.
When are you guys gonna add more rides for little kids? By creating a theme park just for little kids.
Now, by the time Adventure City opened, I was already a little too old for Adventure City.
When I say this is a theme park for little kids, I mean really little kids, like mostly under the age of 10, or at least when it first opened. So my brother and I, we never came here, I don't think, with our parents at all.
And because the train got sucked up into Adventure City,
and because we were getting a little older and some of the shops here that we had liked going to were starting to close up,
our family more or less moved on. That is, until I was 16.
At that time, my parents gave me the keys to their old minivan and told me that I had to get a job.
I had already worked some like construction jobs, concrete, stuff like that, but they meant like a real job, like a sign up and get a paycheck job.
And of course I came down to Hobby City. I'm like, man, there's a ton of stores here all clustered in one area. Perfect place to put in a bunch of job applications. And then I saw it.
An advertisement for the perfect job.
See, my whole life I had been a huge fan of Jim Henson. Giant Muppets fan. Had a Kermit the Frog puppet that I carried around with me everywhere until I was basically 13 or 14 years old. Little embarrassing.
But I had two life goals as a child. One was to become a character at Disneyland,
which at 16 I was still too young for, and the other was to become a Muppeteer. When I found out that Jim Henson's Muppets were based in New York and Sesame Street was based in New York as a kid, I was devastated.
But at 16, when I saw a job posting for Adventure City for a puppeteer,
dude, I knew I had found it. It was me and several other people applying to be a puppeteer for the puppet shows at Adventure City.
They were worried that I was a little too young, but I out-puppeteered all the other puppet masters and got the gig.
Alan Ansdell Jr.'s wife at the time, Michelle, was running the puppet show thing and training us. We were learning how to puppeteer.
And I had a job right there in Adventure City, not only doing the puppet shows,
but also as the mascots for the park, which I think are Adventure Dog and City Kitty, maybe?
There they are. I'm gonna be honest with you. At 16, I wasn't that excited to dress up as City Kitty, but I loved being Adventure Dog.
I also loved being a puppeteer here. I mean, a lot. It was pretty stinking cool.
I mean, it's a really teeny tiny theme park.
But I don't know if you can tell by the lack of activity back there.
By the time I had my job here, it was only open on Saturdays and Sundays, most of the time.
And that meant the only days I could work were early Saturday and Sunday, and whatever other days during the week we had private events or birthday parties or things like that.
And I had to choose between my two loves, because you see, at 16, I had also finally managed to get myself in a band.
Wasn't my favorite band in the world, didn't like the name, didn't like anything about it, but I had a choice. I could play rock and roll, or I could play with puppets.
So I chose rock and roll, but I have very good memories of my brief time working at Adventure City here. Now, Adventure City, I think,
was somewhat the demise of Hobby City.
The idea was solid. Build a park for little kids.
5 miles from Disneyland, 3 miles up the street from Knott's Berry Farm. What could go wrong?
Well, because the family had to finance it themselves, mostly, it was a very tiny theme park at first, and the crowds never really materialized.
A lot of people still don't know that this place is here 24 years later.
Which is a bummer, because it's actually a really cool little theme park.
At one point, around 2005 or so,
the newspapers were all full of information that all of Hobby City and Adventure City would all be bulldozed and turned into condos.
Dude, it was a done deal. Goodbye, teddy bear tree. Goodbye, White House.
Goodbye, gems and opal store.
Built with strange rocks.
They did actually manage to sell off a giant chunk of their property across the street for new development.
But luckily for us anyways, that whole housing crisis thing happened, the market turned, and the deal was off.
And this didn't happen to Hobby City. So it looks like Adventure City is here to stay. Not too much is left to tell the tale of Hobby City.
Even though that's still what it says on the gates.
And it looks as if the last hobby store in Hobby City is closing up.
But the family still owns this place. They still run the place.
And there's still all these amazing themed buildings out here.
So maybe one day Hobby City will make a comeback.
Or maybe Adventure City will expand into what used to be Hobby City.
Either way, I really hope that this place survives.
Because although there's hardly any information online to tell the story,
there's a whole fascinating history here.
Of a former chicken farm turned into an amazing family business.
All started by a couple of dreamers
who believed, like the plaque used to say out here, that a hobby family is a happy family.
If any of you have old pictures of Hobby City in its heyday or old memories of Hobby City, I would love to hear about them. I'd love to come back and do even more now and then with Hobby City.
And who knows, maybe someday I can go back inside Adventure City and take a stroll down memory lane or a ride on that old train.
But for now, that's as much of the story as I can tell you, because that's as much as I know.
So I think we've done our duty.
We can go home
and sleep well.
Hello? Mr. President?
I don't think he's home.
Thank you guys for watching this video. Nowadays, Hobby City's not quite abandoned.
But definitely the old school version of it is mostly forgotten. And let's make sure that that doesn't happen, that it doesn't stay that way, right? If you have any old memories of Hobby City, anything like that, I wasn't kidding, please feel free to share those with me, especially in the Facebook group, stuff like that. Bunch of links down below. I would really love to hear about them. This place is close to my heart. First job was here on the property. A lot of inspiring moments happened to me here as a young man.
And personally, I think that the story behind this family-owned roadside attraction was just incredible, and I'd like to learn more.
But again, thanks for watching. See you guys all a little later. Bye-bye.
Thank you very, very much. I was very, very thirsty.
That's not very funny.
Yes, it is. Very funny.